So warm welcome to all of you. We have a power-packed second half today for all of you. So we're going to get started right away. So the first session that we're going to have is really the journey of idea to hyperscaling and how do D2C brands do it. And I have a pleasure in welcoming and having Meera on board. Welcome, Meera. I'm going to quickly introduce you, Meera. I think a lot of folks probably already know you, but I'm going to take a minute to just introduce you. So Meera comes with about 15 years of experience and started off her career with almost a decade at Unilever, working with brands like Dove, Surf, Vim, and a host of others. She also led consumer insights for the home category during that tenure and analytics and many other aspects. She also then helped scale Big Basket, where she spent a couple of years, and she really grew that into a national brand and grew that top line 4.5 times in the tenure that she was there. She then went on to become the CMO and business head for private labels at MedLife. And again, over there, she had a great journey of scaling the brand and also scaling up the private labels and OTC products. And in her current role now, she's the business head at Dr. Vaidya's, which is India's largest digital-first Ayurvedic brand and now part of the RP Sanjeev Goenka group. So with that, a very, very warm welcome again, Meera.
Thanks, Vikas. Good afternoon, everybody. Absolute pleasure to be over here and talk about the entire D2C sector, which I'm also fairly new to. So I had my journey on the offline CPG brand at Unilever, then joined a couple of retail journeys through Big Basket and through MedLife. Private labels could be considered D2C, but honestly, being a retailer, there is a completely different dynamic that works over there. But this really at Dr. Vaidya's is my first proper D2C stint. And it's been a phenomenal last 7 months digging into this and getting to know so much more about this entire new wave that is hitting us. So moving on, when Vikas talked to me about this one, the first book that came to my head was The Long Tail. And I don't know how many of you have read Chris Anderson's book that was published back in 2004. He really talked about the long tail in the context of three specific categories, one of which being music and online music streaming, the other one being books that was being sold on Amazon, and finally the video or the content library that Netflix had. And he talked about how the sheer number or the sheer volume of these inventories across Rhapsody, Amazon, and Netflix was like literally in a range of 10x or more as compared to the offline store. And yet how it wasn't just the ones that were there on the offline one that were selling, there was a fairly long tail of these services that were being subscribed to and that were being listened to and enjoyed by a fairly large section of the population. Giving rise to that entire book called The Long Tail, right? So D2C seems to be going around in that same fashion that these three things did. Of course, when it is a digital asset, there is no inventory carrying cost. There is virtually no further cost associated with last mile deliveries, etc. So not totally comparable, but what we are seeing today is a version that has been particularly suited of this long tail into the CPG space as well. One of the things that I think I should also put down as a context is why is this long tail or fundamentally the long tail? So you have these large biggies sitting over here in the CPG space, which includes Levers, Nestle, Proctor's, Marico, Colgate-Palmolive, etc. These people are sitting here. These are the biggies. And typically, if you look at it in a brick and mortar retail store, they will constitute possibly 20% of the entire assortment, but they will be contributing to 80% in terms of revenues and 100% of the profits, right? This 80 and 20% in the online space becomes hardly 10% of the overall assortment that there is. And the remaining 90% is an online-only inventory, the yellow one that you see over here. And this 90% over here contributes to about 25% of the revenues and 25% of the profits. So from an e-tailer's point of view, this absolutely makes sense to give customers more assortment, to give this long tail of assortment, it contributes to both their revenues as well as profitability. So it's a complete win-win as far as the e-tailers go with this long tail. Moving on to the right side. So yeah, we have about more than 80 million shoppers that have been added in the last 3 years. Some about 200 million more are expected to join the party by 2025. We have from 376 million active social media users in 2020, we are likely to go to 500 million. Should be like a little more than a third of our population. And we already, as of 2020, have more than 100 funded D2C brands. And their addressable market size is likely to be about $100 billion. These are all huge numbers. And obviously, anyone with that even slightest bit of entrepreneurial spirit should immediately start thinking as to, what is this white space that there really is and what could you possibly look at playing? So yeah, the future of business, CPG included, is in selling less of more brands, but each one having a much smaller share of the entire pie. I remember back in Unilever days, when it came to dishwash as a segment, Vim and Vim in all its formats had 80% of the market share. And then you had Pril, and then you had some, I don't remember exactly what it was called, but you had fairly less number of brands, 5-6 of them. And those 5-6 of them between them were more than 95% of the share. But it seems like the days of that are over with more and more D2C brands taking shape. You will possibly have a far more segmented and a lot of small brands making up the total pie rather than lesser brands making up the Pareto principle over here. Let's move on. So what am I covering today? One, I think three questions that the social media team put across to me. One, how do you scale a D2C brand? Assuming that you have one or you're working on one. How do you make ROAS happen? The golden metric or in some parlances, the ad agencies like to call them Mr. Roy for ROI. And what should be the split of sales from own store and other stores, right? If you are a D2C brand. Let's move ahead. I am over here going to talk about three base criteria for D2C success, right? And if this base criteria for D2C success, which is really scaling your brand, are taken care of, then I think you're in a good shape. So the first one being the gross margin and the AOV mix. As you've seen on the picture on the right side, either you need to have high average order values, right? In which case you can afford a low gross margin. Or you need to have high gross margins in case your average order value is low. But in any which ways, you will be spending at least $90 as the cost of delivery and middle mile alone, right? Not taking into the consideration the marketing costs, the other overheads, etc. that you incur and COGS. So therefore, if your GMV into AOV mix is not working for you, that is the fundamental bit that will, make or break the entire D2C success. You cannot work with small AOVs. You can't work with small ticket sizes on the D2C front because you have far too many other costs coming over here. Unlike, let's say, the sachet market of hair care industry, where it is offline driven, it is like one big assortment going in. Therefore, per retailer, the mix of assortment really makes up for that as compared to the unit price of every individual product that's going in. The second one is clever and meaningful marketing. I particularly emphasize on the adjectives that I've used over here, clever and meaningful. Right? Marketing obviously is required to generate demand. But it, when it comes to D2C, you've often got to be very clever given the limited resources that you have. And it has to be meaningful in that you're not just taking a swipe and a jab at things. You are actually taking an educated guess or at best an educated guess, but more like you really know what you're doing and then you're making it meaningful for the customers you're targeting. And finally, retention. Just one more click, Meghna, so that, yes. And I think maybe if you don't remember the other things, it's fine, but please hold on to everything that I talk about retention in the following slides, because honestly, this is one of the most overlooked kind of a facet, But in the long term, it is your retained customers that will drive both revenue growth as well as profitability for you. You've done the hard work of getting a customer to be interested in you and actually take a punt at you in terms of ordering from you. Make that customer and that customer order count for you. And the only way to actually do that is to look at your retention numbers on whether you're doing it right or wrong. Right, let's move on. Yep. Clever and meaningful marketing. Meghna, maybe you can do one by one, please, instead of putting up everything. Just don't want to clutter the screen. Yeah, thanks. So the first and the foremost thing for me when it comes to clever and meaningful marketing is to understand your target audiences really well and understand them from the point of view of their media habits. There are a fairly large number of syndicated studies that talk about media habits of millennials to senior citizens to kids to, you know, the tweens, etc. So, and if you don't want to subscribe to any of these syndicated studies, your peer set is another place to actually go looking for. They are quite approachable. And honestly, who doesn't like giving gyan over here? Look at me. I'm actually giving gyan in this session today in the afternoon. So I think it is a fairly good idea to know your TG really well, either through syndicated studies or by talking to people who have had experience in targeting these target audiences that you're talking about for your brand and product and service. Finally, if you're already on your way into your D2C journey, right, then you already have your customer base. Talk to them, right? Customers love it when they are approached, but of course at the right time, right? And they will be more than willing to share so many insights about themselves and their lives that will give you a much, much deeper appreciation and understanding of their media habits, and that kind of takes shape in your overall marketing strategy. And honestly, the last statement, I mean it. If you've already been a few years into your business and you still don't know your customers' media habits, ekdam pakka pakka, hand on heart, then shame on you. You really have been doing the entire bit of marketing wrong. The marketing hat, whoever is wearing it in your organization, needs to be, you know, given a serious talking to. In terms of not even knowing this basic, right? Where does this make a huge difference? I think there is a channel mix that you're talking about. Rather than just, you know, go across and pray, you will do so much better if you actually understand this and take a little bit of time to assimilate this particular information. You will, you know, shorten your learning curve, right? And instead of investing in wrong channels, actually do the right thing and move on. I'll tell you, for example, when I was in midlife, my target audiences were older people because the platform is made up of much older chronic diseases patients like diabetics and hypertensives and thyroid and so on. These are not very young people. So Instagram would have been an absolute rubbish channel to be investing in at the point in time, given that these people are not there. Our Facebook is not. But equally interesting is these people have a huge amount of time being spent on news and news media. Right? So therefore, understanding that allowed us to really tailor our channel mix in such a way that it reached out to this audience in the in the maximum numbers and in the most efficient spend possible. Right? But at the same time, if you look at something else, let's say that if you were actually advertising to the millennials, you wouldn't have a media mix that is not that is complete without an Instagram, for example, right? So therefore, understanding media habits of your target audiences is critical to you creating that right channel mix that will take you home in terms of growth and scaling up your brand. Next. Balance reach and frequency. And this is the marketer from offline talking and talking from experience that it also works on the online side, right? One of the things, one of the thumb rules when it comes to offline media planning is to look at reach and frequency as a combination, right? Because you stretch yourself too thin, but give less opportunities to see, or OTS as they call it, your brand will most likely not register. it has there have been several studies that basically talk about the fact that it takes a bare minimum threshold of impressions before something starts registering with you, unless of course it already has a big celebrity face plastered onto it, right? Or has the likes of Modi really talking, which gets your attention immediately. But balancing reach and frequency is critical. I haven't seen success in any campaign that did not have a frequency overall of at least 5 to 7. And even over there, the higher the frequency, the better the ad performance became over time. And I've just given you an example over here, right? Love at first sight, something that is so romanticized in our movies. While it happens with humans in our movies, and I, you know, soundly question that, with products and services, you have got to have a build-up plan. Nobody is going to, you know, suddenly start talking about you, suddenly start noticing you upon their very first glance. It will typically take anything from 5 to 7 or even more, depending on the category, depending upon the seasonality and frequency of buying it. That will actually capture your customer's eye. Yes. And I think this is another important lesson that I'd like to leave you guys with. Don't ever, ever, ever compromise on your creatives. Right? A week's delay is okay, right? But when you have some precious marketing dollars riding on your campaign, get it as right as you can. Don't try to do an MVP over here on creatives. You better invest time, invest the right kind of resources in getting you the best possible creatives. So while reach is important, in my head, I've always told this to my teams, CTR is more important. Don't come and tell me that I reached massive amount of audiences for a piddly 0.2-0.5% CTR. I don't mind you basically reaching a smaller audience set, but where the CTRs are a healthy 2%, 3%, etc. Now that's what we're talking about as good marketing principles. And that's what is really going to take your entire efficacy as well as the scale up. Because when you get your creatives right, you are talking right to your TG. They are liking it. Right? And when you're getting that wrong in terms of CTR, you're doing the converse, which is you are not getting your TG right, you're not appealing to them as much as you should be doing, and therefore are wasting marketing dollars and are also creating a bad first impression or whatever nth impression that there is with your TG. So please never compromise on creatives. You know, take time to make it meaningful, take time to test it out and really understand what works. CTRs are really more important to me as compared to reach. This is one single, mantra that I go with when it comes to talk to both my design teams as well as the performance marketing teams. Next, again, brand marketer talking, but after having ascertained this for the last 6 years on the consumer internet business side, don't shortchange on brand building. I have heard enough people coming up to me and saying ki initially, you can't expect me to be spending on brand. I will have to plug in all my monies only on performance marketing. Right? Fair. That initial period that we are talking about should not last more than a year or year and a half at best. After that, you know, performance marketing alone will not deliver scale to you. It will need brand and performance investments both. You will have to work on creating the top funnel so that your performance marketing doesn't fatigue out and doesn't kind of reach a glass ceiling on its own, right? So, and make brand spends accountable for the right metrics, right? Oftentimes, I have seen people compare brand metrics to performance metrics, saying, ki yaar, yahan par I have optimized it for conversion, yahan par I have optimized it for completed views, theek hai. Instead of looking at the completed views and looking at the actual ROAS over here on the performance marketing side, they will compare ROAS of both. How does that make sense? You did not optimize this for ROAS. It is not supposed to be optimized for ROAS. And what you should always do is retarget people that you have targeted with your branding campaigns and then measure ROAS of those campaigns versus the regular performance campaigns that is going to an audience outside of it. I am absolutely sure, and I've tried this, that the ROAS of the retargeting campaigns for people who've been exposed to your brand is way, way higher. At times, even with a factor of even 4 to 5x as compared to those that are not exposed to your creative. And as a D2C brand, one of the key things that you're trying to do over here to your customers is basically telling them that, hey, listen, I am not some random fuzzy brand. I am actually a serious contender over here. You want them to think of you in that light, right? So please don't shortchange on brand building. This is one of the most important parts of meaningful marketing that you can do. Use tools. One of the things, one of the most beautiful things about online, right? Again, a complete delight and initially a little hard to digest. And then, you know, I took a little bit of time of getting started back when I joined BigBasket. But the sheer amount of data that you have is humongous. You need to either know yourself how to look and derive meaningful insights from this data, or if not, hire someone who is able to actually do that for you. Data and analytics have to be your best friend in an online business. And there is no other way to actually go about it. If you don't have that entire capability or that skills or the liking for it, please have a solid resource in this department who is able to actually draw out data insights. Data insights are today as powerful as consumer insights that come from qualitative research. And this is indeed something that you must make full use of. Experiment. As a D2C brand, you have to experiment, and digital allows you to do that, unlike a TV, right? I remember we had signed on Deepika Padukone as part of that Chhapak movie, which was an acid victim attack movie, right? We created an ad with her, we created a testimonial with her and did all of that. And we started airing it. Within a week of us airing it, she went completely down with the JNU controversy, where she said that she supports somebody, and then the whole Hindutva lobby as well as the, you know, BJP, pro-BJP people were completely against her. But what do you do? Money has already been invested over this entire thing. You can't pull back. And if you don't air it, there is a specific window of airing it. You're gone, right? But thankfully on digital, that's not the case. You are anyways not working with those kind of celebrity most of the times. And even when you have all of these creatives, etc., they kind of cost a fraction to produce as compared to the production cost of an offline film. And you are able to do A/B testing to really build out your overall journey and roadmap towards what really is going to be your space in the creative sense. Right? So definitely do experiment, and these tools are one of the most valuable things that you will have as a D2C marketer. And yes, as a business head, and as having been business head now for the last so many years, you can never take your eyes off the full P&L. Oftentimes, we get completely swayed by the top line, not quite caring to look at the bottom line metrics. If you are a D2C brand, irrespective of the department that you are in, right, at the end of the day, if you're in performance marketing, your job is not only revenue, you should also have a fairly good sense on the bottom line metric. As I've said, topless is a tad better than being bottomless in both people and in business. And this is where I think, there are so many things that you can actually do even through an A/B testing. I'll tell you, for example, in BigBasket, we had done A/B testing where on one particular ad creative and one particular campaign, I gave a percentage of. And on another one, I gave a flat rupees of. Now, I did not, when you look at it prima facie, the one where you had a high percentage of, like a 40% of, 50% of, etc., did far better in terms of clicks and transactions. The one with a flat off did okayish in terms of your clicks and transactions. But when we started looking at the entire funnel, the first one, which was the flat percentage, high discount percentage off, was actually a loss-making one, whereas this one actually improved the profitability, the other one, which is a flat off. So obviously, while you are doing this entire framework of A/B testing, or even when you're doing any of your campaigns, one of the most critical things for you to develop and one good skill set to have in any marketer who's managing the top line metrics is to always keep an eye out on the full P&L, and bottom lines are at the end of the day important, and that's what will sustain you. That's what will get you closer to more funding, more resources, and the ability to sustain a brand for longer. I will take a pause right now. Meghna, if you can take off the presentation and just let me know with the, you know, the people over here, are there any specific questions up to this point in time?
Actually, Meera, there is one question from our audience, which is from Siddharth. So I think his question is, I think to an extent, you did speak about ROAS from performance versus your branding campaigns and it being 4x higher, right? So his question is, how do we measure ROAS from performance campaigns as a result of having done a branding activity? Do you see an increment there as well?
Sure. So if you've done your brand activity right, Siddharth, there are three things that should immediately happen. One, and this is not on performance campaigns, outside of the performance campaigns, you should start seeing traction on your direct traffic stroke installs, depending on whether you have an app or not. Second, related to performance, you should start seeing your performance ads have much higher CTRs as compared to before. So the click-through should increase. The sheer familiarity of the brand that you've created through your brand campaign should increase the click-through rates, because people are now more open to actually learning more about you and trying you. And thirdly, if you look at it from a performance angle again, and this is more on the retention side, this is what I've seen. Any kind of brand burst ends up giving you resurrections, which is people who have lapsed and churned long back are most likely to come back in higher numbers as compared to what they did if you hadn't done this entire brand campaign. Those are three metrics that you should very clearly observe and see an increment on. Like I said, one of the ways to actually also test it out in terms of increment or incrementality to performance marketing performance is to do a set of retargeting to people who've been exposed to your brand campaign versus those people who haven't been exposed to your brand campaign, and see the complete funnel metrics, right from, you know, how do the CTRs compare, how do the conversions compare, how do the ROAS compare, and that will possibly give you a good answer when you're doing it.
No, absolutely, Meera. I think it's important to, like you said, isolate some of these so you can actually track it end to end and compare it.
Don't do it every time.
We have another interesting question from Sujita.
No, I'm just saying, don't do it every time. Once you've done it and you know that this works, kind of take it as a thumb rule. You don't have to keep on reinforcing it again and again through multiple such pilots.
Correct. No, absolutely. Makes sense. We have another interesting question from Sujita, which is, as a marketer, how should you look at the P&L and the business side? And you already touched upon a bit on the gross margins and how you look at the bottom line and the top line. But I think her question is, how should you continue looking at that overall?
See, fundamentally, you're running different kind of campaigns, right? Today, thanks to data being all digitized across organizations, what you're able to do is you're able to take P&L cuts that go by the product categories that you are in. You're able to take P&L cuts also by the geography that you're selling in. So the one, for example, that I was telling you, where we ran a percentage off versus a flat rupees off, what we did was, for all the conversions that happened through one campaign, we looked at saying, this is the total sales that we've accumulated. We already know the COGS, which is the cost of the goods sold in each of these cases. We know how much money you've spent in marketing. And therefore, you're able to actually figure out very quickly, not accounting for delivery and the delivery operational cost for it, which one is making more sense from a percentage perspective. So I think it is important for you to always keep an eye on what is the variable margin that you are delivering across your products. And it should be part of your KRA, honestly. So my performance marketing head's KRA is to deliver on variable margins. Right, saying you cannot take discounting to an extent that it starts really hurting the bottom line. You need to have that balance and you need to ensure that variable margins never dip below a particular threshold that you've set for yourself.
Very helpful, Meera. I think those were two questions from the audience that we had for now.
Yeah, so just summarizing that entire section of clever and meaningful marketing. Knowing your customer media habits will give rise to the right channel mix for scaling up. Secondly, frequency is necessary, not just reach. So keep your eye on the frequency metric equally as much as you have your eye on reach and impressions. Next, don't apply your minimum viable product funders to creatives. You might as well get your creatives right and spend your marketing, you know, well-earned marketing dollars on the right set of creatives that give you returns. Next, have a meaningful brand narrative. And a brand narrative comes in various forms. It's not just necessary to spend big bucks on production, etc. A brand narrative could also be in the form of simple content. At Dr. Vaidya's, for example, our content is taking shape in the form of a lot of doctor talks, a doctor video series, which is really helping people in terms of understanding Ayurveda and what really is the right kind of Ayurvedic products for them and giving them those insights. Next. In God we trust, for rest bring data. The famous quote by one Mr. Edmund, I think. Right? Please have a, you know, really like data. Make it your friend. Next. And finally, business success is a combination of both top line and bottom line. Don't take your eyes off any one of them at any point in time. Importantly, therefore, do your homework before jumping into execution. On D2C brands, I understand there is a bit of impatience, there is a bit of push, stress, pressures, all of those are there. But, you know, the person who did the homework obviously stood a fair chance in being amongst the toppers in the school as compared to those that didn't, right? The same fundas also work over here. I'm going to move quickly to retention. And this is a favorite topic with me. One of the projects that I got in within the first 6 months at Big Basket was really on retention, right? Because we realized that retention should ideally be about 80% of your, or was already a fairly high number, but as a benchmark for any business that is more than 2-3 years old, your repeat customer should be giving 80% of your business and 100% of all the profits, right? Because the new ones are a drain, honestly, on your resources. It's a repeat customer that you really need to cherish. And therefore, you need to know how strong your cohorts are. And you have to make every customer, every single customer count. Because in marketing and in businesses, you know that we are operating on a complete leaky bucket. I'll also tell you the equivalent of this on the offline side of business, right? So on the offline side of business in Levers, Unilever, we had the household panel data. And the household panel data would give you, you know, a split of your users as soulless, core and non-core. Soulless were those users who in the category that your brand was in only used you. They did not use any other brand. So for example, if I was handling Dove soap, within the soaps as a category, my soulless customers was 1%, right? So of the 100% of the customers that I had, only 1% were soulless customers who were using Dove and only Dove and no other product through the entire 12 months of a year. Then we had Core. Core was a set of customers who used Dove or your brand for more than, or had a share of consumption of more than 50%. So 50% of the category consumption belonged to your brand, 50% or more, and the rest were, you know, split between other brands that were randomly tried through the year. And then you had non-core, the real flirters, the fence sitters, right? And very, you know, directly linked, the same thing over here. You will see even on the offline side, despite it being completely, you know, blind eye in terms of retail distribution, etc., that your soulless and core customers contribute to over 80% of your volumes and values and 100% of your profit, because those are the ones who really make up the business, so to speak. Right? So retention is possibly one of the most important things, and across D2C brands today, I see this as the fundamental problem that they're not solving for. They're solving for a product, they're solving for acquisitions, but they are not quite focused on retentions. And that project at Big Basket that I did, and I called it cocaine because I wanted customers to be addicted to us, was something that really helped shape fundamental belief that retention is possibly as important, if not more important, than acquisition once you have a sizable chunk of customers who've already engaged with you and shopped with you. Retention is directly proportional to customer experience, right? That directly proportional sign over there, I hope, not confusing with A. Have you thought through the entire cycle? Just one more click. Right? So you have awareness and consideration. This is where you're advertising, right? You have the whole buying experience. Now, whether it is you know, on your own site or whether it is on a 3P platform or wherever, there is that whole buying experience. There is a delivery experience, there is a post-purchase engagement, and then there is finally the, you know, holy grail of all brands, not just D2C, all brands, which is advocacy. What you want finally is a very large number of advocates for your brand or service. When it comes to the first step, which is your awareness and consideration, a question is, are you setting the right expectations in your ads? Are you projecting the right imagery of your brand? Are you consistent across the messages that you're giving? I'll give you an example. My team, you know, by mistake, launched an ad of one of our products called Live It Up, which is an anti-hangover pill. So you have Live It Up and then you drink, you don't get hangover the next day. This ad got the best CTRs. Till date has the best CTRs, right? And did decently well. But it worked on the basis of a skimpily clad woman showing her cleavage, right? That's not what you want to project as the imagery of your brand, especially when you're trying to be a serious health brand, right? It was a mistake and we rectified it by stopping it. But nevertheless, sometimes you're tempted, right, to use imagery that will, you know, just get you that entire set of clicks and that onward journey. Please don't do that. Ensure that you project the right imagery for your brand and you're consistent across all the messages and product lines that you advertise. Next. When it comes to the buying experience, right, the light blue block over there, how clearly do you give information on your site? How easy is it to understand? Have you put it in, one of the things that I still think we have a long way to go, even a Dr. Vaidya's, is to give information in a way that is easy to understand for people and doesn't leave them with more questions, right, than answers. Have you communicated deliverables and timelines for delivery, when the transaction gets completed very clearly? And have you also thought about what do you have in your product, which is a huge wow factor during that entire buying experience? And over here, when I talk about the product, I'm talking about the app or the website interface, not the product, the physical product, but the website and the app interface that I'm talking about. What have you done over there that's like an absolute delight? I can tell you, for example, on Big Basket, we have a smart basket, which is really about your previous buys. In addition to having the previous buys, we introduced last bought on. That made customer life so much easier, right? Because as you're browsing with your previous buys, you don't have to keep going and checking, do I have this or am I out of it? Because it's very clearly stating that this was last bought a week back. So, you know, oh, this came in last week, so I don't need it anymore. Whereas this came 2 months back, so I'm most likely requiring it. So there are these wow factors on your product. When you create that, makes the customer feel much nicer towards you. And most of these wow factors hinge around creating that sense of gratitude, right? When I see reviews and ratings on a particular site with a lot of reviews being filled up, what do I feel? I feel grateful, one, to the reviewers, two, also to the site for having enabled this and giving me the right information as a buyer, right? Same with, you know, some other examples the previous example that I gave with Big Basket. You want to evoke that sense of gratitude when a person is actually going through that entire buying experience. They look at you far more favorably as compared to sites that don't quite have this. Moving on to the delivery experience, what can you possibly do over here? Did you deliver on the committed date? My goodness, how do you, and you know, one part of expectation setting is this, right? If you've said that you will deliver in 7 days, you bloody well deliver it in 7 days. Don't make it 8th day or 9th day. In MedLife, for every additional day of delivery that we took, our cohorts shrunk by 4%. Can you imagine 4% cohort shrinkage because of one additional day of delivery? How big a hit this is to your business. So delivering on a committed date is like absolute non-negotiable. It is a cardinal sin to breach that. Secondly, did you make an impression at the time of unboxing? Right? Having you know, all of the transactions so far and all that discussion and conversation has happened only virtually. This is the first touch point, the first time that you're actually getting into the customer's hands. How well have you thought through that experience? Could putting in additional 10-20 bucks in terms of that entire unboxing experience over there through packaging and the way you've presented it result in more retention and therefore nullify that cost of 10-20 additional bucks that you have actually invested? It is something that you really need to seriously ponder about. One thing in MedLife, for example, is we used to deliver in these corrugated boxes. These were cartons, and this box was this nice, beautiful box which was branded with MedLife. And 5 out of 10 customers kept these boxes at home. 10 out of 10 customers always talked about the fact that MedLife packaging is the best. It came so nice and it made them feel good about the way that they received it. Was that an additional investment? Yes. I used to spend anywhere between 8 to 17 bucks, depending on the size of those boxes, on just that packaging material alone. But did it pay back? I think so. Yes, it did. Yeah. Next. What have you given the customer that can act as a reminder? Right. So one of the things I told you was the box. People actually kept that box and maintained medicines over there. Similarly, this is an experiment that I actually did back in Divas when I was working on Surf Excel. We did an experiment where we put in stickers, right? And simple stickers with Surf Excel branding and saying that, you know, I love my machine, which was basically to say, by using the right powder, you are actually showing your commitment towards the longevity of the machine. This made such a big difference because one, it was a reminder every time they saw it. And secondly, it led to a much closer feeling with the brand and thinking the brand as a partner in their overall home care journeys that they were having in their homes. So there are things that you can possibly think of leaving behind the customer's home which will constantly remind them of you and therefore keep you top of mind. The next is, how do you intend to quote this customer to keep him or her interested in you, right up to the next purchase? This is critical, right? You go out on your first date with somebody. Are you going to be absolutely quiet? Are you going to just, shut it? Or let's say you've gotten engaged. Up to marriage, are you going to have no interaction with your partner? No. You take that effort. What do you take that effort for? You're trying to build out the relationship over here, right? It's not just till the next time we meet in person again. It's also all the things that happen in between that make up for that entire next meeting that happens, right? So you have to almost think about the customer as your sweetheart and you have to court them, right? To keep them completely engaged and invested in you. And you have to do it in such a way that you're able to keep the noise of competitors from outshouting you to this precious customer of yours. Right? Remember, no customer is insulated from all the competition noises that will come at them. You'll have to ensure that for a retention customer, for a customer that you are, trying to basically keep hooked to your brand, you outshout all of them.
I think there's a question on, for a price sensitive market, how difficult do you think this is, the retaining customers, how does it happen? And because you don't want to rely only on sales, like you said, right?
Completely agree. So if it is a price sensitive market, all the more reason as to figure out saying what is your competitive advantage. No? If it is price sensitive and if you have no competitive advantage, you have no choice. You have to also be price sensitive and absolutely, give the best price. But if you have a competitive advantage, how do you build that in your customers' minds? How do you imprint that on your customers' mind saying that because of this, you deserve me and not the others? That becomes the important thing to really be talking over here to a customer that you've already acquired. Lastly, the advocacy part of it, right? And on post-purchase engagement, let me give you a couple of examples as well, right? So for example, at MedLife, you would only buy medicines once a month, typically. Being a chronic customer, they bought medicines like groceries once a month. After that, you would never want to come back to the site. Who wants to go to a medicine, filled site, right? Unless you have an issue, you will stay far away from it and you will only interact over there once you have an issue and you are wanting to buy something. But in the interim, in that 1 month in between, what we did was, one, we understood that customers had a ton of questions about both their conditions as well as the medications that they were taking, which they never had the time to actually sit with the doctor in detail, in depth, and talk for hours. You know, an appointment is an appointment time, and you're typically a little shy with the doctors over there. So you never really got around talking for hours about all the different questions that were there in your head about both your diseases as well as the medications that you were taking. Secondly, everybody was on a lookout for some healthy options in terms of Ayurveda, homeopathy, etc., saying if I have this, this will possibly help me manage whatever is my condition better. Third, every patient, every chronic patient gets told that they need to focus on getting fitter, which is lose weight and become fitter, and they need to manage their diet, right? Now, all of this, what is the obvious source for them? It is your search engines, right? Like Google. All your questions, you will go and pore over there. Having done a fairly long research on what are the kind of things that people want to know about, what are the kind of diet and exercises that we can prescribe to persons with diabetes versus thyroid versus arthritis, etc., we created a lot of content, right? And we started promoting that, and we started sending that across to our customers, saying, here are your most frequently asked questions answered by so-and-so person who is the dean of this medical college, right? So we took really marquee people as such to actually answer these questions, and in a simple way. The customer engagement was unbelievable, and it was fivefold when we did it in vernacular versus when we did it in English, by the way. That was the other learning over there. Point is, till the next purchase, we came across to our customers as someone who cares for them. We came across to the customers as someone who gave them very, very valuable advice. We came across to the customer as someone who will solve their problems. Wouldn't this create an automatic affiliation to you if you were a customer and you actually got these kind of services? So for every business that you are in, depending on what is a fit, you need to find ways and means of actually engaging with your customers, even in the interim period between the first and the second purchase that has to happen, so that you are more assured and the probability of the second purchase also happening with you is kind of confirmed. Yeah. Lastly, just wanted to talk a little bit on advocacy. You have to be able to identify and create your first tribe of advocates. And you have to be pretty shameless over here in terms of going with a begging bowl to all these people who have tried you and tell them to basically advocate you. Chances are only 1 out of 10 people that you reach out will agree. But that's a starting point, right? Sometimes it could even be 1 out of 100. But you can't give up, right? You just can't give up as yet, because you need those advocates. And that advocacy has various forms. One form of passive advocacy can be just about leaving an honest review. Don't push everybody to go and post a video or a big long post about you. But somebody who is, appreciative of your product or service and is, willing to actually go and put in a review, that also contributes a lot in terms of your overall brand advocacy, right? Referral bonus is another way of actually getting advocacy. And this is one thing that I should possibly tell you. How can you appeal to reciprocity in human nature? I love putting in psychology lessons into most of the marketing campaigns that we do. And one thing is, long back, I don't remember who the researcher was, but one person somewhere, and this is in America, went around distributing randomly 600 Christmas cards, right? A week before Christmas, just randomly. And with written, the said, or the person was giving his address as well. For the 600 cards that person had distributed, 200 of those people actually wrote back to this person. 200, one third of them, right? And he explained that by saying that we as a human, as per our human nature, have this entire value of reciprocity. You can't just allow something given to you, which is a nice gesture or a nice thing, go by without reciprocating. So are you as a brand able to do something that evokes this reciprocity in your customers? Think about what could that be and actually put it into action. Yeah. Next, so just retention mantras. I think how do people remember you after the transaction? Next, how did you help them? Right, the entire reciprocity one. then next? And what do you share with them? And will they actually, you know, care to share it as well onwards? Next. And honestly, it is better to halt growth if your retention is poor. Please fix retention issues, or else you will have a bottomless bucket, not a leaky bucket. Leaky bucket at least retains some water. You will become bottomless if you don't fix retention issues. Yeah. Next. Finally, just quickly moving on to ROAS. I think, you know, ROAS is one end metric, which is to your far right. There are a series of metrics over here. Sorry for the raw, you know, poor readability. I didn't think it would be like this, but you first optimize cost for the right relevant reach. You hit the right frequency to create consideration. You need to optimize to get to the right CTR. You need to further work on your product to get the right landing page views and least amount of bounces. Then you need to have the product completely catered to lead to signups, add to carts, lead drops, etc. And finally, you need to have the right transaction rates. ROAS is a accumulation of all these previous six metrics. It is not just one singular metric. And often I have found people obsessed on that ROAS term without quite obsessing on each of these six that actually precedes ROAS. So given that it is a summation metric and not a standalone metric, if you want ROAS, you need to be hitting the levers for each one of these individual six building blocks that make up ROAS, and not just one out of these six or two out of these six. All six are important, and that is what will really maximize your ROAS. Next. And yes, one strong correlation. The stronger your brand, higher will be the ROAS. It uplifts every metric along this entire thing. You get reach at lower cost. You get higher CTRs as compared to brands that are relatively unknown. You get lesser bounces. You get more add to carts and more transactions coming if you have a stronger brand. Next. Own store versus 3P. Last couple of slides over here. I think own platforms drive higher loyalty. No doubt about it. But 3Ps have a much higher base and traffic, right? Own platforms will give you rich insights, but 3P relationships can also lead to pretty much a lot of insights, at least a part of the insights that you're talking about getting from your own site. Next. And 3P platforms have higher trust as compared to a newbie in the market, right? But, you know, you will not be able to engage these buyers once they buy your product from them, right, to plan for and ensure repeats. Next. I think how much in terms of value Rokada sales trumps, you know, where you sell, whether it comes from your own site or 3Ps honestly in business. And as a D2C brand, being available on all other platforms is a good thing. It only adds to a lot of trust. Next. It is cheaper actually to sell on 3Ps initially, while your own marketing costs are quite high. That's coming from, you know, my own experience. Next. And finally, I think you have to, when you're selling on 3P, be clever to figure out how you can influence the next purchase to happen through your own platform rather than through the 3P again. Yeah. That's about it. I'm sorry I, you know, possibly took a little more time than was planned.
I could see from the presentation and the conversation we had before the doing the preparation that you've really put in your entire 15 years experience into this deck and customize it for us. So thanks so much for taking all the time to really prepare and deliver this. I myself had lots of questions, but I'll definitely take it offline and take it up. But thanks so much for joining us today for the Digital Leadership Summit.
Sure. My pleasure. And you know, all the best to all the D2C participants over here. I think this is the age of D2C. You know, rise and shine.
Absolutely. Thanks, Meera.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Meera. I really appreciate it.